Hello and welcome to our new webinar. I am here today to present to you a new webinar about building an EA. We will be waiting a minute or two for the others attendees to join us. Meantime, in the questions section of the GoToWebinar interface, we can chat a bit, and I would like to know from you if everything is fine, image, sound. Eventually, where are you from? I see Ravi Chandrian from Toronto. Is it fall yet there? I guess we are the lucky one. The lucky ones to have four seasons, Canada. I am currently located in Romania, and all the signs is gonna be a long fall and hard winter are in place. Sounds good, says Aline. Hello, Aline. Okay, if you've participated before to one of our webinars, you know generally they are structured as a presentation, and at the end of the presentation the recording will be available on our website, and you will be able to go through the recording and see it however many times you want. If you have access to our students section of the forexboat.com website. Meanwhile, speaking about our website, we are currently running a giveaway to promote the brokerage services of our partner, broker partner, and to offer and sponsor one trader by funding one real account with $2,000. You can participate in our giveaway by entering, and there are daily entries. More entries you have, more chances to win the prize. The prize is $2,000, and the giveaway page can be accessed at our website forexboat.com/giveaway. I see more people joined, and out of respect for the ones that were here in time, and we'll try to start the presentation. Before that, I am directing your right attention to the disclaimer that you may be familiar with, and all information provided in this presentation will be offered under this disclaimer. We are a regulated company, and our services are not to be taken as trading or financial advice and are for education purposes only, and will be taken as such. Please take a minute and go through the disclaimer, then we can start. Meantime, during the presentation, if you have any questions about the content of the presentation or any part of the explanation that you feel needs more clarification, please feel free to ask the questions in the questions section of the GoToWebinar interface, and I will try to address them accordingly during the presentation or at the end of the presentation when we will reserve a few minutes at the end for questions and answers exclusively. So even during the presentation you can ask questions, some will be answered during the presentation, and more of them at the end. Okay, let's roll our sleeves and let's begin. The presentation today, I was thinking at suggestive enough title to not only entice but to stimulate your curiosity and why not your interest. As traders, whether we have experience or not in trading financial markets, at some point in our development, in our trading journey, comes one point when we are thinking about automating some tasks or an entire trading process or trading strategy. That is where we are trying to build or code trading robots or expert advisors, and this presentation wants to be an example about how we can build a simple expert advisor, a simple trading robot, like approaching the problem like the simple problem that it is, because the build itself is not very complicated. What is it's complicated? Improving the performance of the robot we are building, or improving the trading algorithm that we are using. Whenever we are trying to do something as humans, as traders, as programmers, we have a goal, and to reach that goal we need to have clear enough the succession of steps we have to take in order to reach our goal. If our goal is to create a simple trading robot, a simple expert advisor, we will plan for it and we will achieve it. It shouldn't be more difficult than taking a piece of paper, folding it and making a plane out of it. A paper plane is one of our childhood's toys, and that paper plane can be as simple or as complicated as our abilities can make it, and it can be improved in its future iterations to be optimized for whatever needs to be optimized after we've already tested the first versions or the previous versions. From this EA build, we have to get our expectations at the level, at a reasonable level, let's say. Many traders believe that they can transform their first $100 in $1,000 or $10,000 or even more overnight. And in practice, some of us already know it's not possible. Many of us will learn in time that is very hard to do. And the failure rate in general is partly due to the fact that the expectations we have from our trading, whether it's manual or algorithmic, are set too high or unreasonably high. So the expectations in this case have can be in regards to a few, let's say, a few things that we are watching and trying to achieve. As far as planning the future EA, we have to have a clear goal about what we are trying to do, and in today's build we will be trying to make, from the point of view of functionality, a trend following robot that will take one single trade at a time, that will be unidirectional, so it will have open at the same time only buy order or only sell order. In regards to speed and frequency of trades, we will be trying to make it enter a trade or analyze if it's appropriate to enter a trade on every bar. It will use market orders. It will set fixed take profit and stop levels expressed in pips, in distance. From the profitability point, our EA ideally will have to make profit. If our expectation is to make a good profit from our first try, that may be unrealistic. And as a rule of thumb, programmers don't expect their first version to be profitable, because usually it isn't. And the profitability of a certain trading algorithm depends on so many factors that the chances of it being profitable from the first try are slim to none. It depends, the profitability depends on what pair we will be trading, what values our stop loss and take profit will have, what entry algorithm we will use, and many other factors that will come into play at the right moment. Speaking about the plan, our plan will include nothing more that you see on the right. What you see on the right is the whole robot itself. Every line will be doing something at a certain moment. all the lines are all written in a specific order in order to achieve what we are trying to achieve, and in the order the those things can be achieved. So as a framework, this paper plane will have a fuselage, will have wings, will have let's say wheels, because it needs to fly. And our robot, our trading robot, in order to achieve what we've proposed earlier when we were talking about expectations, we will need a few functions to make sure those points are touched and addressed. So we will have, in order to make it trade every bar, we will have to make it aware when a new bar just began. We will have to have a way to generate a signal. We will have to interpret that signal and place an order accordingly. We will have to modify the newly placed order to assign the proper take profit and stop loss values, and eventually to understand, to know, to see whatever the EA is doing at any moment. We will have to have some sort of display that will show us the status of the trading robot. So these points will be touched and addressed in order to achieve our goal, to make a trading robot. So the first point, functionality wise, will be touched and addressed by employing the use of a function. We will call it is time to trade function. The signal will be given by another function. We will be calling it get signal. The placing of the order will be taken care of by another function, the place order function. The setting of the take profit level and the setting of the stop loss level respectively will be taken care by two separate functions. And why is that, we will discuss a bit later when it will become obvious. The structure of this simple robot, trading robot or expert advisor, will allow us to make easy improvements in the future for its next versions, and that will be possible because the logic and the succession of the trading operations and calculations and decision making will not be crammed remote inside the trading robot in one place. The sections we need the robot to execute will be called and executed in the order we specify, and the code can be as simple as it's visible on the screen now. If you don't think a robot can be that simple, maybe you are used to another coding style. I prefer to arrange the functions I need to put in a robot in such a way that they can be called and executed on need to execute basis, and not program the robot in and write the code in such a way that it's a long and convoluted story, hard to follow. So this should be what we are using to write the robot, and once the code will be written, we will need to make sure it is working properly, that is taken care in the testing process, that shouldn't be too difficult, shouldn't be made too hard to do, and what we will be testing for, we will make sure that the robot is placing the trades when it is expected to, that the robot is placing the trades which are expected to place. So we will verify the correctness of the signal that is generated, and that will give the trading direction. If our testing will then make sure that the orders are placed and modified according to our settings, and the displayed information is true and useful. The stage after the testing should be optional, let's say, but no matter how experienced or not we are in programming, it is always useful to actually see what the robot does, and that includes values of some variables it is using, parameters that it is using, or what's the account status, or other things like that. So, this being said, I propose you, if you, there are not general questions at this point, and I see you are not asking anything, we can move on and effectively put together the robot, trying to follow what our plan was. So we are trying to do a robot that will touch these points, and for that we will be switching to an MT4 platform that I already installed. We can launch the MetaCodes language editor, and upon launching that editor, we can start to build our robot. The written code we will be using, I will try to explain each and every line or function we will be using, what it is doing, and how does it achieve the thing it is intended to achieve, and all the code will be available in our private trading group on Facebook, or if you will ask for it will be sent by email. You may address the email to our support staff through the website, through the forums website, or in the Facebook private trading group. So we have launched the Meta Editor, and here we will be select file, new, expert advisor, and we'll make one called paper plane. The template the editor is presenting us with has the usual sections, nothing more, which we will populate with code we need in order to make a functional robot. So in the build, we will need to have a robot that is not only placing trades but is also managing trades, and because it will need to manage trades, it will have to have a way of understanding which ones are his own trades and which are not. And for the event, the robot will have to pick and choose from trades that are already open on the platform. Let's start by bringing in some code, and this I will explain what it does. First, we will assign to the variable called ID the name of the robot. This variable we will be also using as comment to mark the orders we will be placing with our robot. In settings, we will be giving control to the user to choose a magic number that will mark the orders placed with the help of this robot with a certain magic number, and this is the way the robot will be aware and will have the means to discern between its own trades and the trades originating from other sources, whether manual or other robots. And the variable called the debug on we will be using to selectively display, or if we choose to not display, some information on the screen. The next section we will need in the settings section will be addressing a few orders characteristics that are needed for our robot. So we will be using the variable lots with this value to specify what is the fixed lot entry of every trade. We will be specifying also the slippage the robot will take into consideration for the event. Slippage will occur in fast moving markets, and we will also be using another variable over which we as users have control, and we'll set it to 1 to instruct the robot that it should take one order only, and any more than one is not allowed. Then we will need as well in the settings section of the expert advisor the I call the MA slope, which is the name of the strategy we are trying to use. And being a trend following robot, we will be employing the use of a moving average, and we'll take into consideration the slope of that moving average in order to assess whether the trend is still going or not. Then, to take care of other two important functions of any trading robot, or of most trading robots, we will use these variables I call take profit and stop loss, that are self-explanatory, I believe, that will be used by the robot to set the levels accordingly. Because we are using a moving average in our robot, we want some flexibility in order to be able to easily choose between certain types of moving average, certain lengths of moving averages, certain prices that the moving average is calculated based on, and so on and so forth. So we will be using, in order to generate the value that the robot will take into consideration, we will use these variables that are under user's control also. We have period shift method and the moving average price to determine what and how the robot is calculating. Then I also included a few other variables that are not under user's control, and you see they are not expected, we are not expected to enter any values as before, because these are in global variables that the robot will use internally without our intervention. Again, if you have any questions about these sections, please feel free to ask it, any questions you would want to ask in the questions section, and I'll try to answer it now or at the end of the presentation. Now that we have sketched, let's say, we have drawn a general plan, and we have set the parameters the robot we will be using during its run. What we need now is to get to put together the parts, the functions that together will make a working robot. As I've mentioned before, the code itself, in order to achieve what we are expecting to achieve, these are the general expectations we have from this robot, should be fairly simple. And I promised you that the code that controls the whole robot will not be more complicated than what you see on the right. And what you see on the right is what the robot will do and is instructed to do whenever it is given control from the platform. That section of the script of the code is known as the on tick section, which is called and executed every time a new tick comes into our platform. So when we launch our application, our MT4 application, and we attach the robot to one of our charts, that robot will run again and again through the same series of instructions every time a change in price will occur. And that is happening because we are writing in here in the on tick function whatever we need the robot to do, and we will try to put in this section the parts I was showing you earlier. I will explain every one of you of these parts to you, and you will understand why I keep saying it's not very complicated. So we are set to make a trading robot that uses a signal and that is placing one trade every new bar. So we must have a way to check whether a new bar is formed, and when that happens, to generate a signal based on our moving average, in this case on our algorithm, and according to that signal to assume a direction to enter either a buy or a sell. So this part that does what I've just mentioned can look like this, and in plain English should be something like this. If it is time to trade, so if this function returns the true value, that means we are allowed to trade, the robot is allowed to trade, and then the robot will execute whatever is in between these brackets. The first instruction within these brackets is will assign to the variable called signal the value that the getSignal function will return. The is time to trade function and the getSignal function are two functions that I already written, and I will show them to you, and we will include them in this robot. So getting back to the logic of this section, when it is time to trade, we will know if it is time to trade because that function will answer us and will give us the true value, not the false value. Then signal will become a 1 or a 0, will have a value, and that value we will use in the function called getIn1. This function will take into consideration two values. It will take into consideration, in order to place a trade, the lot size, which we are setting manually here as input variable, and with will take into consideration the signal that it just got from the getSignal function. Let's see how the function we are trying to use here are looking. The first function we are using is the isTimeToTrade function. isTimeToTrade function should tell our robot if it is allowed to place a trade or not. And that function we will be placing at the end of the robot script. And it looks like this. And it says that whenever it is called, the variable called TTT, time to trade, is default, it is false, and if bar time, which is a variable we've set here, and it is used to determine whether a bar has changed or not, it holds a value of the date and time it is changed. So if the bar time value is different, so it's not equal than the value of the current candle on the current symbol on the current time frame that has shift 0, so when the bar time is different than the current bar's time, then that means we have a new bar. And when we have a new bar, the time to trade variable becomes true. It is default false. By default, it is false. And if we are interrogating this function, it will return TTT false almost all the time. So it is time to trade, I'm asking. And the function returns TTT. If it is a new bar, that TTT is not false anymore, it is true. And when it is true and returned as true, then this condition becomes actionable. And then we will need that the signal variable be given the value of another function. And we will see how the getSignal function looks like. It is also a simple one that will use a few lines of code. So this is, let's put it above the previous one to be able to see the on tick section and the function we are talking about at the same time. So now we need a signal, and that signal will come when we call this function. So when the code is executed, sometimes this is false and nothing gets executed, and when it is true, then these lines are executed in order. The first line makes that the signal variable becomes a 1 or a 0 according to what this function will return. And this function will return a value depending on what we are writing inside of the function. We are trying to use one particular strategy, and I called it MA slope, because the same code can be used later to add different strategy. Let's say here we want to add another strategy later, and we can call it RSE overbought oversold, let's say. And if we want to run both strategies in the same robot, we can use in our getSignal function another section like this that will generate not an MA slope signal, but an RSI OBOS signal, let's say. And we will take into consideration not one signal, but two signals, or three, or more, or less, whichever, however many we would want. But in this case, we have only one strategy, that is MA slope, and that is based on a moving average. So in order to have a moving average value, we have already put in our robot some parameters for a moving average, these parameters. Okay? And these parameters will be used to generate a value for the moving average we will be using in order to generate the signal. and that signal will be used to place the trade. So to get the value of the moving average, we can either write this every time we need that value, or we can write a function that will return the value of the moving average for that specific symbol, for that specific time frame, with periods and shift and method and price and shift value for the moving average. So I am using this function to get the value for the my moving average that has shift 1. The last value, the value before the current bar. And I am also using the value before that. So my moving average with a shift of 2 will return the moving average from the last 2 bars, because we can, if we have a moving average, let's say a 20 simple like we are using there, our robot is executing at this moment in time. And in order to execute, it needs to assess if the slope of the moving average is ascending or descending. So we need to have the value of the moving average as it was here at the previous bar, and the value of the moving average as it was here at the bar before that. And this is bar 1, this is bar 2, and this is bar 0. So in our code, we are using, we are determining what is the slope of the moving average, knowing these two values, moving average for the last bar and the bar before it. Comparing these two values, we can determine if the slope is up, going upwards, or if the slope is down, like it is maybe in another part of the chart. Let's say here. When the slope is down, on this bar we will have this value, and on the bar before that we will have a bigger value. So in our code, this part is taken care of here. So my MA1 is my moving average shift 1, and my MA2 is my moving average shift 2. And we don't have to write this whole puhaha here. Now we are generating the string, the signal that will be used to give the value we will return. And if the price that is drawing the chart is greater than the moving average from the last bar, and the moving average from the previous before last bar is smaller than the moving average of the last bar, then the slope is up. So the signal will be up. If conversely the bid is below the last value of the moving average and the one before that was bigger than the one from the last bar, then the slope is downwards. And when we have a slope upwards, then the signal will be buy. And when we have a move downwards, then the operation we are seeking to enter will be a sell. And this is how the get signal function is working. In order to assign to this variable a value of 1 or 0 that will correspond to an operation that is a buy or a sell. Moving on to the next operation that will take place in our robot on that new bar that just happened. So we now know it is time to trade. We have obtained the signal, and we know if we want to buy or sell. And now we have to get in one trade to get in using the lot size we are choosing and the signal we've just obtained. So we are looking for the, and for the function that will place the trade, and this function looks something like this. And this function takes in as input values the lot size and the direction of the trade. And we've established that we want a robot that will trade in one direction and will place one trade only, because we have set the max orders to one. And here we can verify in this section of the getInOne function if the number of active orders is smaller than the max orders that we've set to one, then and the operation that we've just get from the signal we've just got from the signal is a buy, then we will place an order in the direction of buy with the lot size we've specified. If the total active orders is smaller than one and the operation we are trying to enter is a sell, then we will place a trade in the direction of a sell with the specified lot size. What we see here is that we will need this function, place order function, that will take care of the placing of the order specifically, because this getInOne function is used mainly to decide whether it is opportune to place a trade now based on the max order number or whatever any other criteria we would want to employ or design in our future robots. And then it passes the control and asks for actual placing of the order. And the place order function, it is written distinctively, separately, because there may be cases where you want to place, let's say, not market orders, but pending orders. And using the same function and the same sequence of callers, we could modify only this place order function, for example, and make it not buy on market, but place a pending order, let's say. And this function gets what is given, the direction and the lot, that is the type of the order and the lot size. The place order gets a type and the lot size, refreshes the rates to make sure that it has the most recent prices, and then places, if the type of the order is a buy, it will be using the ask price as the placing order price. It will be a sell order, it will be using the bid price as a market placing order price, and the send order function on this symbol in this direction with this size, with this or this price, with the slippage we've established earlier, and with the comment we've also established earlier, that is in this case our robot's name, with the magic number that the EA has, will be placed at market. And this concludes the placing of the order itself. Then, as I've promised, we have to take care of our take profit and our stop loss. In both these cases, I've considered adequate to use two separate functions, because there may be cases when we can employ one specific algorithm in order to determine or to set the take profit level, and another algorithm in order to set the stop loss level. We may set the stop loss, let's say, by following a moving average, and we make set the take profit not by using a fixed value, but by reading a volatility indicator like average true range, for example. So in more volatile markets, the take profit can be farther away, or in less volatile markets, the take profit can be closer. And that could prove more effectively in some other instances. But in this instance, we will be using for both this take profit and stop loss functions the fixed values we were we already set when we've launched the robot, when we are attaching the robot to the chart, and we'll take a look at the code that takes care of the settings of the take profit. This line in plain English says this: if take profit is different than zero, then call this function and give it the value that we've set in order to modify the take profit. Why, if it is different than zero? Because it is a good thing to have a way to disable one specific function. Let's say we do not want to trade with take profit, then we simply put it to zero, and zero, as we see in this comment, disables the function itself, because the function will not be called unless the take profit is different than zero. So if it is zero, this line is not executed. The same way, the stop loss is working, and the stop loss setting function is given the value of stop loss only and only if the stop loss value is different than zero. If we want to trade without stop loss, we make it zero or 10 or 20, and then we will have a value. Let's put this 15 and 10 for the moment. And now let's take a look at how this set all TP function looks like. This function should go through all the active orders that are placed by the robot we are using and should modify the take profit level to the level according to our variable if that specific order has no take profit value. So when this is called, this is executed and is given a value, and that value is used to be incremented, to be added to the open price. So going through all the orders, we are selecting one by one each order, and if that order is recognized as being an order placed by this robot because it is on this symbol and has this the same magic number, then we are looking at the order type. If the order type is a buy, then the take profit becomes whatever order open price was plus the take profit value we were getting. When the order type is a sell, then the take profit becomes whatever order open price was minus the corresponding value. Here we have another function we are using in order to transform, to convert the value we are entering in the robot from pips to points, because on four-digit brokers pips are pips, and on five-digit brokers the values are in points, but we may want to use pips as a also as a general value to set the stop loss or take profit. And then this function pips to points transforms according to what type of broker and quotation we have access to, transforms that value by multiplying with the appropriate multiplication factor. And then when we have a broker that gives us five or three digits in the JPY case, then the multiplication becomes 10, and that is multiplied by the point value, and we practically are getting this 15 pips take profit value becomes 150 points value. So that's a small trick in order to keep consistent and have the same values here as take profit and stop loss, whether we are on a five-digit broker or on a three-digit broker. So this is what our take profit setting take profit level function does. And once we have the take profit levels, if the take profit of the order we selected is zero, which means it has no take profit level on it, and the take profit level is different than zero, then we have computed a valid value, then we modify the order, the respective order, with the respective value. The same way we are doing for the take profit, we also have a function for setting the stop loss levels that is following the same algorithm, and the only modification is that for the buy orders we have to subtract the distance from the order open price for the buy orders, and we have to add that distance to the order open price for the sell orders, because on any placed order we have, for a sell order, the value of the stop loss is added to the value of the order entry, and the value of the take profit is subtracted, is smaller than the value order of the entry. And conversely, for a buy order, we have to have a take profit that is bigger, that is above the entry price, and the stop loss that is below the entry price. And this is done in these two functions, set all stop loss and set all take profit. And as I promised, the code of the robot itself is not bigger or more complicated than this, and all the inner workings reside in the functions we are hiding out of plain sight, and we are putting at the end of our code in order to get a cleaner look at what the robot is doing and in what order. The last piece of the puzzle I was proposing you to include in our robot is placing on the screen some info about how many active orders we have at a specified at any moment in time, and what is eventually the status of our account, to have a clear picture. And if the debug on variable is set to true, the variable that is under our control when we are launching the robot, if this variable is true, then this line is executed and this function is called, and this function displays the information I was talking about. And the simple way to achieve that information display is this, using the comment function that will print a few lines on the screen. And I made it look somewhat organized. And we have a new line, and this string, and a new line, and this string, and this variable, and this string, and the variable, and the new line, and this label, string, and this variable, and so on and so forth, in order to achieve what we are trying to achieve. So if the debug is on, this will read the bar time value and the latest signal, and we will see them on the screen. It will also read count all active value, that is a function that will count our active orders that are placed by the robot and are currently active, and that function looks like this. So we have a variable called count that is at zero by default. Then for we are writing an a loop in which we are going through all the orders total, and one by one we are verifying, we are selecting each order, and we are verifying if the order is on the symbol of the chart, and if the order type is smaller than 2, which means it is a 1 or a 0, which is a sell or a buy order, and if that order's magic number is our robot's magic number, then we increment the value of that count that is initially 0, that becomes 0 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1. So every time we identify one of these orders and we establish is one of our own orders, then that is counted and the result is returned, and it is used here to display that value, or here to compare and decide whether we will be placing an order, because we established that we want to place maximum one order at a time. Like we've checked for here. Okay. And now, having this robot, this sequence of commands, this sequence of instructions will be executed in order every time a new price change will occur, and it will result in a placement of the order based on a signal that we've generated, and that order will have take profit and the stop loss set to it, and information about that order we will have on the screen. And now that we have all the pieces in place, we've already compiled the code. We see we have zero errors, zero warnings, and we should have the compiled product, the compiled robot here. Let's see it in strategy tester. Let's put it on a currency pair. And what are we trying to do? We are trying, because we've touched all the points we've proposed, we are trying to get to where we are testing it. And as we've mentioned before, we will be testing if and when it is placing trades, if and when the signal is valid, if and when the order placement results in a valid order actually placed, and that order has its take profit and stop loss values changed to reflect what we've instructed the robot to do, and if we have on the screen values that we want to have, or information about what we want to read or see. And let's put from 1st of June this year to 1st of September this year on H1 with a spread of 20 points in visual mode to see what we are after and to actually see what the robot is seeing. Let's make a template, a chart that will auto-scroll, that will have bars, that will have a moving average, and we already chosen a moving average of 20 simple close, and we will be using in our template 20 simple close. We can make it look orange, and be a bit thicker to be easier to see. And this template to be loaded by the strategy tester itself when it launches, we will save it and we will call it tester. And this template now, when we are testing paper plane robot on the EURUSD with every tick on the H1 with a spread of 20 from the 1st of June to 1st of September in visual mode, it should launch the tester template and it should begin working. And as we see, the robot is placing trades. As we also see, we've asked it to place a take profit at 15 and a stop loss at 10. Let's check if it does that. 150 points, which is 15 pips. And the stop loss of 100 points, which is exactly 10 pips. And if the moving average is sloping up, it is placing buy orders and it is also informing us about what it is doing now. In the upper left corner, using the comment function, we are seeing here the bar time is 1st of June, hour is 5 o'clock, operation is 0, which means a buy. 0 as in I have nothing, I want something, I want to buy, or 1, which is I have something, I want to sell. In this case, it's a buy. Active, we have 1 order, the balance is this, the equity is this, and the free margin is this. And if we let it run, it will place orders according to the algorithm, as long as it is above the moving average, it will place buy orders. And when it comes below the moving average, it places sell orders, which have the same values, 15 take profit, 10 stop loss. Now let's see in the journal if the first orders are placed at the beginning of the bar, which we've asked it to do at 1st of June at 15 o'clock sharp, the order is open, then it is modified and it is given a take profit and a stop loss in two separate operations, which means our functions are working one after another, which we've intended to do. And it is running as we've designed it and asked it to do. And this should conclude the demonstration part of the current presentation. And now, let's see if we've touched all the points. Beautifying the interface I was talking about earlier. It is a step in our robot development when we are trying to make it easy not easy to use not only by us, the designer or the coder, but by any other trader that would come into contact with it, and that can be achieved simply by making sure that the code itself has this particular property specified, property strict, and after each line we are including as a variable under user's control, we can comment that variable in order to get the interface to print not only the name of the variable, but the explanation also, like it is in this case. I'm trying to show you. See here about the take profit, we have in parentheses 0 equals disabled. That would not be visible if this line wouldn't have a comment on it. If we erase that comment, that line, the take profit variable doesn't have an explanation anymore. And that makes it sometimes harder for other people to use our code, and that is why as a coding practice is better to include these comments. Another thing for us to be helpful for future developers or to help ourselves for future developments, we can also comment some variables we are using, like I did here, or here. What is this function doing? It is counting all active orders. What is this function doing? It is parsing all orders and sets the stop loss on them. And when a coder or another developer comes upon this, it takes less time to understand what this is doing if we have commented code. And this should cover the clear parameters explanation part of the presentation. As we've seen, the current signal and the current state of the account and the print section. I am trying now to address any and all questions you might have regarding, let's say, this presentation first, then maybe general questions, and general in the sense of addressing things that might prove to be useful not only to you but to other traders too. And meantime, I will ask you also to address to ask any questions you might have, and answer this little poll we are having that is meant to give us a better image of what we've managed to achieve by presenting this webinar to you, and what we are expected to do next. Maybe improve on our presentations and topics and whatever other interests you might have as traders or programmers. I'll leave the poll open a little while, And you may also ask questions, please. I am watching the questions that are coming, and I'm reading what Jan asked. Is there a possibility to control the speed of backtesting in NT4 in some way? If I move the display mode speed to 32, it is impossible to follow, but if I move it to speed 31, it's too slow. The speed of the backtesting, as we all know, is a bit flaky. I don't know if it is by design or by chance, but that is what we have to work with. NT4 platform is in this way. What I find useful is if I want to have a slower execution time while backtesting, and I need, let's say, a value between 32 and 31, I can slow down the code by making it do things that it doesn't really need to do. But by doing that, it can be slowed down. Or if that is an option, you can change the time frame, and the granularity of that settings can be somewhat more manageable. On H1, for example, the maximum speed is you can follow, is quite easy to follow. But if you are testing on M5, usually a fast robot will be too fast to follow at the maximum speed. As an example of how to slow down the robot and make it do useful or useless things in order to slow it down, even the last part we've discussed, printing some info on the screen using the comment function, for example. If we make it print something every tick, and that something is a few lines long, it will spend some time printing useless stuff, and then it will be slower. Ravi asks, how can I address error messages in journal? Error messages are many kinds. If you can be more specific, I'll try to be more specific. But error messages in journal, usually they are self-explanatory. And whatever error you see in the journal section of the NT4 platform, whether you are testing or running it on live data, they usually give us in that journal enough information to debug, to pinpoint what the problem is or how to address it. Is there an easy way to debug, not by using log messages, asks Jan. The debugging part takes more time if you've written the code in such a way you can follow yourself. What I've proposed to you today, and the way I've proposed you to write code, should shorten the debugging time, because every function runs in its own sandbox, let's say, and you can see pretty easily if the error you are getting is because the stop loss isn't functioning properly or the take profit isn't functioning properly, to refer to the today's examples. And if one function isn't functioning properly, then having different function that perform different functions makes it easy to debug. I cannot offer a universal. It all resides in how easily to follow you make your own code to be. If you make it easily to follow its execution and you understand what you've written, the debugging part comes naturally, I think. And I see the poll has reached its goal. Let's conclude it. And I thank you for sharing your opinion. And I'm glad you've turned out in such big number. For me, it's a big number because I didn't do many presentations before this. But I hope that together we can be part of many more. And why not? Maybe we will work together on something more interactive. And now that I've presented a coding style that is accessible and easy to understand, even for inexperienced programmers, we could collaborate on this or other projects. From time to time doing this kind of presentations or in our private trading group on the Facebook or in the forum through our website. Feel free to participate in any of those communities, and we will try to be there for you and address your questions. I see Ian is commenting. Yes, you are right, but sometimes the expert does not do what I expected it to do, and then I start writing log messages to verify value the AI uses for entry or exit in order to identify the mistake. Yes, that's the tricky part. Get the robot to do what we need to do, and if we are writing the code in transparent enough, let's say, manner, then I believe that we can pinpoint faster any problems that may occur. Let's say that an error you are getting refers to how the take profit is placed. What programmers do, insert usually in the function they are suspecting is causing the error, because the error has a code and every code means something specifically. And if they narrow down the cause to a specific function, they can write in that function code to print, to put in the log, like Ravi is saying, to put in the log text that may help us debug. And let's take this as an example. If the take profit by some mistake, we are reversing, let's say, a sign here, and for the buy orders, we are not adding the distance to the order open price, we are subtracting that distance. Then we will get most probably an error. And that error, to be pinpointed, we will have to, let's see, it tried to place a buy, it placed a buy, it managed to place the stop loss for that buy, but as we see, it didn't manage to place the take profit. Why? Because we've deliberately, this time, we've modified this sign here, and the value for a buy, the distance of the take profit is not added to the order open price, but is subtracted. And as we know, the take profit cannot be before, cannot be below the level of the order entry price. Is the if the order entry price is for a buy order, and in the journal we have an error. And this error says order modifier 130. This error, if we are looking for it in the help F1, we will see that corresponds to order modification that cannot be done, because you will have there some pointers to then this troubled, let's say, function can be debugged, as Ravi Ian, I believe, mentioned, can be debugged by inserting some code. And we are trying to insert code that will make us aware of what this specific function is trying to do at this specific moment when it is given an error. And this may be, let's see here. So if this condition, so if we don't have a take profit on that order and we've computed a take profit, then we will put some brackets here, because now we will have two operations to execute when this condition is met, and we will try to print text that will say, trying to mod TP from order take profit, which is now, to the value that was computed. Order trying to modify text value, text value. And now by printing this information, we should have in between the errors in our journal the text we've designed here. And the way we've designed it, that text should have error, text error, text error, text. That is practically telling us what it's trying to do. See, we have an error and then our text. And our text is saying, trying to mod TP from 0 to 112299. And looking at that, entry price is at whatever, 12449, and it is trying to move it from the entry price that is 12449 to take profit that that is 12299, which is lower. And because it is a buy order, it cannot be lower. And this text that we've inserted here can help us debug this and see that for a by we have to add a distance, not subtract that distance. And that code can remain there, be made dormant, and then eventually used like so in the other. Stop loss function that is basically, that has basically the same structure and is trying to do the same thing, and just by modifying this, we now have a way to see into what the EA is doing, both when it's setting the stop loss and when it's setting the take profit also. And even if they don't, even if they won't produce errors, they will at least produce valuable information. Try and mod SL, try and mod TP from 0 to, and we have a peek into the EA inner working. This we can also make it conditional. Let's say if the bug on, then we will have this print also. And if we do not want to have the print in the journal and the upper left corner info on the screen, let's see if that will increase or decrease our execution speed. This is the maximum on H1. It's pretty slow, if you ask me. Now, let's just put the debug to off. Let's get rid of the useless or less useful prints. And the same EA with the same settings on the same computer, on the same time frame, should run faster, just because we've removed some tasks from its stack, and it is no longer wasting time printing and printing and printing and writing in a log file and so on and so forth. Debugging can also be done using breakpoints and making the EA stop after some operations, but usually the letting it run and looking at the journal and inserting text that will result in alternating messages from the strategy tester that will give us the error and from our code that will give us the context, let's say, where the EA is when that error occurred, that should help us debug it faster. Pavel comments, in some cases, news could go against the expert advisor and could drain your account if stop loss is not set properly. Yes, that's true. That's pretty self-evident, if you ask me. There are ways to mitigate against that risk, and you can have written a function that watches for big candles, let's say, and you can have any trade closed if the, let's say, the floating loss for that specific order goes over a certain limit. Even if you don't have a stop loss on that order, you can have a function that looks at every order and calculates what is the value of the floating profit, let's say, at that specific moment. And if it is beyond 2% of the account, let's say, it can forcibly close the order even if it has no stop loss. Let's say the market jumped over your stop loss, but you can still close it at the closing price at the market. That may be a way to mitigate against news risk. Just an idea. I see there are no more questions, and I thank you again for coming. I invite you to participate in our community. I will try to help you as much as I would be able to, and all the staff will do the same. Thank you again, and I wish you a good evening and happy trading.